Good day everybody. In this video I would like to talk about geophysics and we'll look at seismic waves and how we can use them in soil mechanics and geotechnical engineering. So we're going to start with fundamentals. If there is any earthquake, it will generate movements of solid particles, and it will generate those waves that will actually push those particles around. So you probably know there are two major waves. The first one is known as P wave, or it's also primary waves. So in this case, if we have this wave, and this is actually a very fast one, it comes first. So in this case, this wave will displace particles in the same direction of wave propagation. So it displaces in this one. You will see we have compressions. So it will compress the soil or rock mass. So the other wave, which is very important, it's called a shear wave or secondary wave. So or also we call it S wave. So in this case, it will displace particles perpendicular to the direction of wave propagation. So this is actually the most dangerous wave in terms of the stability of either soil or rock mass, because this wave will lead to either liquefaction or it can also lead to landslides. So this is the one, this is really important, and this is the one that we need to consider in stability analysis. Now let's look at this diagram and we will come up with the fundamental definitions. So this is very common curve. You probably seen it in many textbooks. So you will see this is a particle movements during wave propagation. And we can use either time here on the side or, on the x-axis, or we can use distance. Let's start first with the time and we'll look at this wave. So this is going to be the wave. So this is amplitude. We also call it A amplitude. We're going to look at one cycle. We'll start with this crest and it finishes here. So this distance, we can call it T because we use now time. In this case, it's also called the wave period. And once we know the wave period, we can estimate the wave frequency. This is commonly used, so this is the formula here. So let's look at some examples, and let's say that the time of this wave propagation is maybe 2 seconds. So in this case, we can estimate frequency as 1 divided by T, which is the time, 1 divided over 2, 0.5 hertz. So we use hertz, right, to measure frequency. Okay, so let's say now we're not going to use time, so we're going to plot the same data, but instead of time, we're going to use a distance. So let's look again at maybe slightly different wave here. So we're going to identify crest and crest here. We're going to identify this one as lambda. And this is the wavelength, so the length of this wave. And there is a formula here that can be useful if we estimate, for example, velocity. So if we know the frequency and if we know the wavelength, we can estimate the velocity. Let's look at another example. Let's say that we have a wave with the wavelength of 500 nanometers, and we have a frequency that this wave has it's 1 times 10 power of 14 in hertz. So we can estimate the frequency, sorry, we can estimate the velocity, and the formula will be here, it will be lambda times frequency. So we're going to have 500, and we'll change it to meters. So nanometers, it will be times 10 in the power of negative 9. And then frequency is 1 times 10 power 14, right? So if we do the calculations, it will give us the answer of 5 times 10 power of 8 meters per second. So that's how this wave is going to propagate, is going to travel with this speed. Okay, now let's go to the next slide and see what else we have. So I like this picture, this figure. I took it from this textbook. So this is the textbook. If you're interested, you can look it up. So that actually shows you geophysics, how we do it in the field. It's not very difficult procedure. I think the most difficult part is the analysis of the data, because you'll need lots of experience to correctly identify it. And even then, there are some things that sometimes it's very difficult to interpret correctly. So I'm not sure if you're familiar. I think I've had a couple of videos when I discuss geophysics. The procedure is we have just these geophones. So these are sort of receivers. We put them at certain distance from each other. Usually it's about 1 meter distance. And then we are going to generate a wave. So in this case, it says short point. So it can be a little blast, or it can be like, you can hit it with a big hammer. So once you hit the ground, it will generate waves. And waves will start propagate through soil mass, rock mass. So when they come to the boundary between two different strata, so here, for example, bedrock, and this is overburden, maybe soil. So wave has this tendency to reflect. So they will reflect, bounce back, and go back to one of those geophones, where we actually record the time necessary for this wave to arrive at these geophones. So this is the procedure, how it works. And then there's software. We're going to use software to do analysis. We'll look at the time, how it propagates through the soil mass, either overburden or bedrock. And what we're going to come up with is waves. And not actually waves, we're going to come up with the velocity of each wave. And I'm not sure if you've seen results of this seismic geophysics investigations. You will see all these contour lines. And then, for example, say 350, this one says 400. So these numbers means velocity. So velocity of the waves, either P waves or S waves. So usually S waves, it's more important, because secondary waves, they only go through the soil, and they're going through the soil skeleton, when P waves can also travel through water. And for soil mechanics, S waves is more important, because it will correlate to the properties of soil or rock. Another thing that we know, this is a correlation, it's very rough correlation here. So this is S wave, it's actually smaller than P wave, it's about 0.6 of P wave. Another thing that you may use sometime in the future when you analyze the data from geophysics, it's this more accurate correlation between P wave and S wave. So here we use Poisson's ratio. But this one, it only works when the soil or rock mass is homogeneous. So in this case, for this particular case, this correlation will be valid. So, but I think the most important that we commonly use, and that's why we use geophysics, it's this one, this correlation, because in this correlation, we can estimate shear modulus. And shear modulus for small strain, So it's like less than 1% strain deformation. So for this one, we can estimate shear modulus, and it will give us some idea about the strength of either soil or rock, depending on what we investigate. So let's just look at some example and see how we can do that. Let's, for example, say that we did some investigation of this soil mass, and it gave us that this S wave was about 300 meters per second. So you see this table that you see here, it's kind of reference estimations of velocity of wave for a different type of either soil or rock. So you will see that these values will increase when the density of soil or rock will increase. So if we have soil, usually we have a relatively low values of velocity. So when soil becomes a little bit stronger, or it turns into sedimentary rock, so you will see that values will increase. And then when we actually go through very hard rocks, you will see that a velocity will be very, very high, which means that this wave will travel much faster through rock compared to soil. So let's say that we deal with maybe some, I don't know, let's choose that it was clay, which is saturated. And our analysis, our geophysics gave us the velocity of 300 meters per second. And we also took some core samples, and we estimated that unit weight of this soil was 20 kilonewton per cubic meters. So what we're gonna do right now is estimate this shear modulus. So we're going to use this formula. There's only one given here. You will see that this value, this factor, is density. So we need to change unit weight to density. If you don't know how to do it, please watch my videos on soil mechanics and soil constituents. So I'm going to write here that density is unit weight divided by value of g, which is gravitational acceleration value 9.81. You should remember this one. So that will give us 20 divided by 9.81. And that will give us approximately value of 2.039. And the units, be careful here, grams per cubic centimeters. So what we're gonna do right now, because we're gonna divide it by velocity, right? No, or multiply it. So we need to change to meters. So in this case, if we change these values to meters and kilograms, that will be density 2039 kilograms per cubic meters. Again, this is very standard procedure. Watch one of my previous videos, how to convert the units of density and unit weights. Okay, so now we are going to estimate the value. So in this case, we have velocity of 300. So in this case, that would lead us to shear modulus. So we can actually write that we put it in the power of 2 velocity, and this one is going to be g divided by density. And from here, we're going to say that shear modulus, it's a velocity in the power of 2 times density. So velocity, it's 300 in the power of 2. And we're going to multiply by density 2039, and that will give us a value of well, I already changed it to MPa. It's going to be 183.5 MPa megapascals. So first you're gonna get a value in pascals, and then you just change to MPa, because that's the units we typically use for very hard rock or soil. Okay, that's it for today. I hope you've learned a little bit more about geophysics. Thanks for watching this video. Don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe. Have a nice day. Bye.